Hello everybody and welcome to this video in which I want to explain you a few basics on abstract measure theory. Well, I know that physicists don't usually learn measure theory, which I find a pity, but I can't change this, of course, and therefore let me begin in a quite elementary way. Now, what is measure theory about? Well, I guess all of you are familiar with integration in some way or the other. So suppose we consider an integral f of x dx. Well, and then one wants to put this whole integration theory on a nice mathematical basis. And then it's a good idea to begin with the integrals of characteristic functions. So which are denoted like this. Suppose we take now a subset here of the real numbers, and then we introduce the characteristic function by saying this is 1 if x lies in U and 0 otherwise. Okay, and then if we integrate over this characteristic function, this is what is called the measure of the set U. So you can think of it as the volume of the set. If one takes for U an interval, this is simply the length of the interval. And well, first of all, I should say, like, if one knows how to integrate characteristic functions, then one can also get a corresponding integration theory by suitable approximation. So one considers whatever sequences of step functions which converge to f in a suitable sense, and then one can also get the corresponding integral. And I don't want to enter the details, which are a little bit technical, but in any case, so the main goal is to define the measure of a set. As I already said, I mean, for certain sets, it's clear how to do this. I mean, if I take an interval, then the measure is simply the length of the interval. The tricky question is, for which sets can one define such a measure? And a related question is, like, which properties does this measure need to have in order to get a corresponding nice notion of integration? Well, and it turns out that one cannot arrange that every set is measurable. I mean, this leads to contradictions. Mathematicians tried this for a while, but the conclusion to this whole problem was that one needs to distinguish a certain subset of set or family of subsets for which this measure is defined, the so-called measurable subsets. And, well, what these measurable subsets, they have certain properties, and the basic thing to keep in mind is that one can perform only at most countable set operations. So this means if one takes whatever, any collection of measurable sets and takes their union, this won't be measurable. However, not in general. However, if one works with a finite number of set operations, say finite unions or countable set operations, so countable union, countable intersection, then the sets stay measurable. So this is like the main idea. And here, so let me just write this in words so that you remember this. So mu can be defined only on certain sets. Just write it in this vague way. I mean, there will be the precise definition anyhow. On certain subsets of R, the so-called measurable sets, And working with these measurable sets, one is only allowed to perform at most countable set operations. Okay, and this working with at most countable set operations, this is captured by the notion of a sigma algebra. So this is what I will define next, and then we can define a corresponding measure. Well, and we do all this abstractly in the sense that we do not introduce a measure on the real numbers, but on a general set, which we call E. So let E be a set. And now we consider a family of subsets denoted by M, like the measurable sets. So this is a subset of the power set of E. And this is a sigma algebra. If it has the following properties. First of all, the empty set is in M. The second property is if the set is in M, then also its complement is in M. So then the complement of A is also in M. Combining this with the first property, also the whole set E is measurable. And the third property is that it is closed under at most, or let's write it as for countable unions. If we take a sequence AN, N in N, then all the ANs are in M, then also the union of these ANs is in M. So this is a sigma algebra, and then the sets in M, or the elements of M, let's better write it like this, are called the measurable sets. Okay, before going on, maybe just a few quick remarks. Well, here we have a statement on the union of a countable number of sets. One can also work with finite unions simply by adding the empty set. I mean, the empty set is measurable. Now you can take, suppose you have a finite number of sets A1 to A capital N, which are all measurable, then you complement them by the empty set, and then this infinite union reduces to the union of the first capital N sets, and then one sees that they are this finite union is again measurable. Okay, next, this is a statement for unions. Using the fact that the complement of a set is again measurable, one gets a similar statement for the intersection of sets. So namely, more precisely, the complement of the union is the intersection of the complements. And using this, one gets a similar statement also for the intersections. So therefore, in total, what this means, if I take measurable sets and then I perform any at most countable set operations, unions, intersections, complements, I again get a measurable sets. Or one can also write it in shorter terms, a sigma algebra is closed under at most countable set operations. Okay, so now next, what is a measure? a measure, let's denote it by mu. Now this is a mapping from the sigma algebra to the positive real numbers, including zero and including plus infinity. So in other words, to every measurable set, we associate a non-negative number or infinity, which you can think of as the corresponding volume. And this has certain properties. First, the measure of the empty set is equal to zero. Well, this is not surprising. And the second important property is now what is called sigma additivity. Namely, if we take again a sequence of sets which are all measurable and are pairwise disjoint. Then the measure of the union of these sets is the same as the sum over the measures of all of these sets. Okay, and of course, at least for finite unions, this is what you would expect. I mean, if you take like two disjoint sets, well, then the total volume is just the sum of the individual volumes. The point here is that this works also with countable unions. Okay, this is sigma additivity, and these are already all the properties of the measure. Good, now let's move on to integration. As I said, this can be done with a suitable approximation process, which is somewhat tricky. Therefore, I don't want to tell you the details. I just want to tell you what the result is. And there's one notion one needs, namely that the function should be measurable. What does this mean? And let's do this only for real valued function. Well, it works for complex function just as well that you say, well, it has two components, the real and the imaginary part. And then if both the real and imaginary parts are measurable, then also the complex function is called measurable. So therefore, going from real to complex or vector valued mappings is not a big issue, and therefore let's restrict attention to real valued functions. Suppose we have a function f from e to the real numbers, then this is called measurable. If the pre-image of any open set is measurable. So if f to the minus 1 of u is measurable, so it's a measurable set, maybe I should write it like this, is an element of M for all open subsets of the real numbers. Okay, so this is an important notion, and this is a large class of functions. In particular, all continuous functions are measurable, at least with respect to Borel measures. But in any case, so this is a sufficiently large class of functions. For such functions, one can integrate the absolute value. So for measurable functions, so the integral over e absolute value of f of x d mu x is well defined, but it could take the value plus infinity. So let's write it like this. So this is of course non-negative, but it could be infinite. So this is mathematically well defined. If this integral is finite, then we can also integrate without the absolute values. If this integral is finite, then we can also integrate f of x d mu x, and what we get here is a real number. And this is again well defined. Well, how can this be understood? Well, the basic problem is, so what we should avoid is that we get something like infinity minus infinity, because this is not well defined. So we have to avoid that such something like that happens, but this is ensured by assuming that this integral is finite. So this means both the positive and negative parts of the integral are finite, and therefore also this integral is well defined. So I mean, here we have positive and negative contributions. This is why the integral could also be negative here, but in any case, it can never be finite, and therefore it is well defined. Good, and such functions are called integrable. And the integrable functions form a vector space, which is denoted by L1. So L1 of E d mu, so this is the vector space of all integrable functions. Well, in fact, on this vector space, one can also introduce a norm. So the norm of f, which is then the L1 norm, is defined by integrating over the absolute value, just as we did above. And it turns out that this is even a Banach space, so this is like a complete normed space. Let me just mention one more thing here, namely, one can also consider other powers here. Oops, sorry. And let's just consider the case of square integrable functions. So if the functions, and let's call these functions are called L2 of L d mu, so the square integrable functions. So these are all the functions f measurable and the integral over f of x square d mu x is finite. And on these functions, one can introduce a scalar product, namely f g, well, I denote it like this, or here I write L2, defined by the integral over e f of x times g of x d mu x. So this is then a real scalar product. I should say if we take complex valued functions, as I said, everything works pretty much the same way. But then, of course, one has to complex conjugate here, and I always use the convention that I take the complex conjugation of the left argument. Okay. In fact, maybe I should better write it like this, because this is, in fact, how I usually denote the scalar product, the L2 scalar product. Okay. And of course, there are all these LP functions, and well, in any case, integration is well defined if one works with such measurable functions and imposes that the integral of a certain power of the absolute value of the function is finite. Good. Well, I don't want to enter into more details here, but I want to introduce a few other concepts which we need. Namely, in the previous video, we saw topology. Now here we see measure theory. The question is, how are the two connected? And in fact, in most applications, they are connected. It's a related question is, well, here we introduced the notion of a sigma algebra, but how should we choose it? I mean, there are many different sigma algebras. Is there a distinguished sigma algebra? And in fact, there is, namely, the topology gives rise to a natural sigma algebra. And this is the sigma algebra which we usually work with, and this is the so-called Borel algebra. So this means we now consider the case that we have a topological space. Let E, O be a topological space. And then the so-called Borel algebra which I usually denote by script B for Borel. So this is the smallest sigma algebra which contains all the open sets. With, let's write it like this, O is a subset of B. So this means every open set is Borel measurable. Okay, if you feel a bit uneasy, what does it mean, the smallest sigma algebra? It turns out that if you take the intersection of sigma algebras, this is again a sigma algebra. Therefore, one can take simply the intersection of all the sigma algebras which contain the topology, and this is the Borel algebra. Another way of thinking about this, which I find a bit easier, although it's maybe not quite so convincing mathematically, is, well, one starts with the topology, so the open sets, and then one performs all countable set operations, and then one creates a whole bunch of sets, and these are precisely all the Borel measurable sets. So one can also write this kind of a bit informally, so all the sets which can be generated from the open sets using at most countable set operation. Okay, so this is the Borel algebra, and then the sets in B are called the Borel set, the Borel sets. So the elements of B are the Borel sets. And a measure on the Borel algebra is a Borel measure. A measure mu, so then this is of course a mapping from the Borel sets to R plus zero and infinity is a Borel measure. Okay, then usually we'll work with Borel measures. I should say that the Lebesgue measure, which you are probably familiar with, or might be familiar with, this is not quite a Borel measure. It's like an extension of the Borel measure, where one adds all the subsets of Borel sets of measure zeros, like the completion of a Borel measure. But these are more details. In fact, for our purposes, it's best to work with the Borel measure, so we do not take the completion. Okay, there's one more notion which we will need, namely the notion of a regular measure. Okay, namely this is like a specific class of Borel measures which fit together nicely with the topology. And more precisely, what one wants that one can approximate from outside and from the inside. And this is what regularity of the measure is about. In fact, if we consider the existence theory for the causal action principle, then we will always work with regular Borel measures. So this is the correct class of measures to work with. So therefore, let me give the definition. When there's the definition of outer and inner regularity, and regular is if it's both inner and outer regular. Okay, so now this Definition is a Borel measure mu is outer regular if the measure of any set A is the infimum of the measure of omega, where omega contains A and is open. And of course, this should hold for any set A, for any Borel set A. So this means the measure can be obtained by approximating from outside with open sets and taking the infimum. Similarly, it is inner regular. Well, if we can approximate from inside with compact sets, if the measure of A is the supremum of the measure of K, where K is contained in A and is compact. And this should again be true for any Borel set. Okay, and the measure is regular if it is both inner and outer regular. Okay, I should say that so the Lebesgue measure is regular, and somehow this follows from the whole construction. I mean, if you remember if you saw the construction of the Lebesgue measure in a lecture, it always works where you approximate from inside, from the interior with compact sets, and from outside with open sets, and it's like a double procedure for approximating. And all this is done in such a way that you get really a sigma algebra of measurable sets. But these conditions here, they come out of this construction, and they make precise that the measure really has this nice approximation properties. Okay, good. I think this is all we need. I mean, for example, we need more, for example, the support of the measure. But since this notion is not quite so standard, I will explain this in detail in another video. Okay, good. So I think that's all we need here. I hope you found this helpful and hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.